Good afternoon. Today's service will be participatory, and so we hope that you all have a worship bulletin. Everything is included in there for you, so you won't have to flip around and look for things. So we invite you to follow along, and if you don't have a bulletin, there are more in the narthex or lobby area. Any of the worship responses will be listed in bold for you. At this time, we'll rise as we begin worship. Welcome in the name of Jesus, the Savior of the world. We are gathered to worship, to proclaim Christ crucified and risen, to remember before God our sister Rosalind, to give thanks for her life, to commend her to our merciful Redeemer, and to comfort one another in our grief. When we were baptized in Christ Jesus, we were baptized into his death. We were buried therefore with him by baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might live a new life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. Eternal God, maker of heaven and earth, who formed us from the dust of the earth, who by your breath gave us life, we glorify you. We glorify you. Jesus Christ, the resurrection and the life, who suffered death for all humanity, who rose from the grave to open the way to eternal life, we praise you. Holy Spirit, author and giver of life, the comforter of all who sorrow, our sure confidence and everlasting hope, we worship you. We worship you. To you, O blessed Trinity, be glory and honor forever and ever. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. O God of grace and glory, we remember before you today our sister Rosalind. We thank you for giving her to us to know and to love as a companion in our pilgrimage on earth. In your boundless compassion, console us who mourn. Give us faith to see that death has been swallowed up in the victory of our Lord Jesus Christ, so that we may live in confidence and hope until by your call we are gathered to our heavenly home in the company of all your saints, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. We sit.
service. Service above self. The Body family believed in service through work in the church. Mom was born the second of three girls to the third generation Lutheran minister, Reverend Earl K. Body, my namesake, and Annabelle Dantzler Body, all nearly a century ago. The first, Geraldine, who we call Gigi, was a distinguished nurse at Duke with a bachelor's from Lenoir Rhyne College, a nursing degree from Johns Hopkins, and a master's of nursing from Case Western Reserve. Mom graduated from Lenoir Rhyne as well with a degree in early childhood education and received recertification later from NC State University as she continued her teaching career. Jacqueline, or Jackie as we called her, graduated from Women's College, which is now UNC Greensboro, and went on to obtain her MD degree from Women's Medical College of Pennsylvania in Philadelphia. Yes, it was not as common at the time for women to obtain MDs. She went on to serve as an OBGYN for all, including accepting the Medicaid patients who needed care in her region. After all, they were all pastors' daughters. Mom began her lifelong educating career, teaching third grade back in Kannapolis, where her parents were and where she graduated high school. She then moved to Durham, where she taught and attended church. She became further acquainted with her future husband, our father, Lewis, through church functions. Now, Mom did not drive at the time. She would wait by the curb for a ride to school outside the home where she rented a room from a spinster. Dad made it a point and told Angela at another time, it was a little out of my way, but he would drive by in the morning, blow his horn and wave. And in her words, embarrass me to death. Dad was a few years older, having left Durham High his senior year to endure 30 combat missions and bombers over enemy-occupied Europe on the Pathfinder lead plane for the 389th, the Sky Scorpions. They're quite famous. He was a highly decorated veteran who had returned home to finish his education, which he did utilizing his GI Bill, graduating from Duke in 1951 at 27 years of age. They married when Dad was 29, saving Mom from the old maid school teacher labeled when she was 26 years old. Living in the Duke University apartments, Alan and I were born to the couple. Dad's work transferred the office to Raleigh, and while there, Angela was born. When we were old enough to attend, Mom taught at the certified Longview Methodist Church preschool for 6 years. She was coerced back to public school at Powell Elementary for a year and then on to the rest of a long tenure at Lacey Elementary, teaching second, and then she was the first to start kindergarten in Raleigh, which she preferred the rest of her career. Mom taught until she was 65 years old, leaving early each scheduled day to drive across town in time to get to Lacey so that the little ones have an accepting presence when they arrive, she said. During her weekday teaching career, Mom also headed and taught preschool and was head of the Holy Trinity Lutheran Church preschool for 20 years, every Sunday without fail. You could hear her singing voice accompanied by her auto harp, echoing through the hall past the parents vying for a look through the window to to watch the children march in a circle around her as she sang, and the one little duck with a feather on his back, he led the others with a quack, quack, quack. That's how she ended every session. At Holy Trinity, Mom gave of her drama talent, formulating, directing, and acting in the Christmas play Why the Chimes Ring over many years. This involved over 50 people, including grown men who she coerced into wearing costumes that included tights. Mom had a knack for promoting her way, and most succumbed with a yes, ma'am. One of our childhood memories we three recently recall was our family outings all together. Remember, Mom didn't drive till her 40s. So we'd all get together, with Dad driving, of course, in the same car. Some Saturdays, we went downtown Raleigh to spend half a day at the four-story belt store. They had all Mom wished to shop for all of us. We'd usually wind up eating in the cafeteria along the way and take a walk up the street to Britton's shoe store for our updated shoes. If we went without Dad, we walked a good bit up Dennis Avenue, past Lyons Park, to a bus stop, and after a transfer, went on to our downtown shopping trip. We returned the same way, bus, transfer, bus, and a long walk home carrying our packages. What memories. We recently found a folder with letters from children, parents, and principals praising her work ethic and caring attitude. She was interviewed in 1987 for a newspaper article entitled Profile of a Teacher. She summed up her philosophy stating, "I enjoy being with people, specifically with small children, or I wouldn't be a teacher. As a teacher of children entering public school for the first time, I try to accept each child at his level, challenge him to learn at his rate of progress, and help him to develop special interests through which he can express himself. In addition to her work in the classroom, some of the activities Ms. Bowling had done to help students include coordinating and directing the Wake County Public Schools System's health fair, where she helped plan a special program for classical studies magnet schools like Lacey and working with the writing to read curriculum. Mom was actually the first teacher to be a consultant to IBM's first software for education and taught the program to other school systems." Mrs. Bowling says one of her strengths lies in the fact that I consider myself a loving person, though one with enough firmness to encourage good behavior and help the students get the work done to the best of their ability. I like to provide creative experiences to expand talents and interests in learning. Preparation for good teaching takes many hours. However, I find pleasure working to provide an interesting program and a pleasant environment for the pupils placed in my class, she summed up. One of her doctors, a colleague of mine in Pinehurst, retinal specialist Dr. Greg Mincy, best described Mom in a statement he sent upon her passing. "She was a handsome Southern woman with impeccable manners and that impossible to define confidence." This past January, Mom was in her new dentist office, who recognized her name as being her twin sister's kindergarten teacher in the early 90s, the end of her career. She called her sister, who made a short video telling Mom how she remembered her giving her a great start in school and life. Mom was her favorite teacher of all time. Mom was thrilled. Her work had carried on. Mom was one of a few who received a retirement pension longer than working a three-decade career. To 65, not someone who retired in her 50s. She loved the presence of children, spending time with her 6 grandchildren, and recently spent craft time with her 2 great grandkids. Mom volunteered in schools, churches, retirement communities, end of life situations. She loved the arts, crafts, nature, and growing and arranging flowers to share with others. She was social until the end of her long life and spoke highly of her friends and staff at Cypress and Rosewood, telling us how glad she was to have lived her last 15 years there. At her retirement luncheon some 32 years ago at the old Ballantyne's Cafeteria in what was then called Cameron Village, Mom recited a now lost poem she wrote. It described the life of a tree, beginning with the acorn from its mother, the continued growth from sapling to a tall, widespread shelter for birds and other animals it shared its branches and leaves with. In time, with weather and drought, the tree began to wither and eventually fell. However, animals utilized its trunk for a home, and its remnants disintegrated into substance for the new growth, the children, who then benefited from the big tree's lifespan. How fitting. Another example of her life in her own words. The teacher, the servant, the giver, the encourager. Now, Mom, rest. You've done more than enough. We all thank you for your life.
To see your life unfold. I was there when you were but a child, with a faith to suit you well. In a blaze of light you wandered off to find where your life dwelt. When you heard the wonder the word, I was there to cheer you on. You were raised to praise the living Lord, to whom you now belong. When you found someone to share your life, and you joined your hearts as one, I was there to make your verses rhyme from dusk till rising sun. In the middle ages of your life, not too old, no longer young, I was there to guide you through the night, complete what I'd begun. When the evening gently closed in and you shut your weary eyes, I was there as I have always been, with just one more surprise. I was there to hear your morning cry. I was there when you were old. I rejoiced the day you were baptized to see your life unfold.
A reading from Revelation. Then the angel showed me the river of the water of life, bright as crystal, flowing from the throne of God and of the Lamb through the middle of the street of the city. On either side of the river is the tree of life, with its 12 kinds of fruit, producing its fruit each month, and the leaves of the tree are for the healing of the nations. Nothing cursed will be found there anymore, but the throne of God and of the Lamb will be in it, and his servants will worship him, and they will see his face, and his name will be on their foreheads, and there will be no more night. They need no light of lamp or sun, for the Lord God will be their light, and they will reign forever and ever. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please rise for the reading of the gospel. The Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Glory to you, O Lord. Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. Yet I tell you, even Solomon in all his glory was not clothed like one of these. But if God so clothes the grass of the field, which is alive today and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you, you of little faith? Therefore do not worry, saying, what will we eat, or what will we drink, or what will we wear? For it is the Gentiles who strive for all these things. And indeed your heavenly Father knows that you need all these things. But strive first for the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated. Last Saturday, I went with my 7-year-old daughter to Duke Gardens. Of course, it's beautiful all year round, but this time of year, the enormous terraced garden is fully in bloom with tulips and irises. In the middle of a city, it's a giant hillside of abundant, delightful color. I was thinking about Rosalind the whole time. As my daughter and I meandered toward her favorite aspect of the garden, which is the popsicle stand, we found ourselves, in kind of a silly way, exclaiming over and over again, oh, wow, look at that one. Look at that one over there. Look at this color. Oh, I think this is my favorite. No, I think this is my favorite. All of that beauty, all in one place, almost stunned us. The sheer color of it, the variety and the detail, all of that abundant life and beauty for free for us to enjoy right in our backyard. You all will know better than I do that Rosalind just loved flowers and all of the flower adjacent things, the birds and the springtime and the beauty of nature, children and art and family. For years, right here at Good Shepherd, she took the Sunday flowers to homebound members to add a bit of beauty and joy to their day. Our gospel reading for today reminds us that these flowers are not only beautiful in a small, fleeting, unimportant way, because the flowers show us a bit of who God is and what God is all about. We're asked to ponder these lilies that are grown by God for the pure joy of it, just for their beauty, because God loves things like that. They don't work, they don't toil, they don't do anything particularly useful, they aren't productive, they are simply delightful. And God values that. God values that delight and beauty enough to make it happen in our world. God creates and cares for such things, things as small as the lilies, and delights in their existence. And God provides all of the things that they need to grow. In this depiction of our Almighty God, I hear so many of the things that I have heard you all say about Rosalind. That she cared for these kinds of things, beautiful things, in a world that can be so harsh and practical. Rosalind wanted to make sure that things were also perfectly lovely. And in the beauty that she brought into the world, we see the beauty of God's creation reflected. We see God's love and care for each one of us, for each child of God, gorgeous in the eyes of our Maker. And like the God who concerns himself with some of the smallest things in God's creation, with the flowers of the field, Rosalind too concerned herself with some of the smallest folks in our midst. We heard about how she taught children for decades as a kindergarten teacher, a Sunday school teacher, even a Sunday school superintendent for years and years. Like God does for each of us, Rosalind gave those small ones what they needed to grow and flourish and learn. And she did so in a way that brought more beauty and joy into the world. And now, having served so very well, having reflected these lovely aspects of God so faithfully and steadily her whole life long, we can rest on God's promise that Rosalind is now enjoying the stunning beauty that is beyond our comprehension. The beauty of the fullness of God's presence that does not ever end. Perhaps we can rest on the image of the kingdom of heaven that we read in Revelation that was echoed in Earl's words a few moments ago, the image of that tree of life with fruit for the healing of the nations and room for everyone under the shade of its branches. We can rest in the promise that Rosalind is experiencing that stunning beauty and joy in color and variety and detail, abundant life given to her for free, given to Rosalind, and given to each and every one of us for free and forever. Having served God, her family, her church, and her community so well for over 90 years, now Rosalind can simply enjoy the beauty and the peace all around her. May we trust that perfectly lovely promise of God, now and always. Amen. Now let us rise and sing together.
Thank you.
We confess the faith together in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty. Let us pray. Almighty God, in holy baptism, you knit all people together into one communion of saints in the body of Christ. Give to all people in heaven and on earth your light and your peace. Lord, in your mercy, give courage and faith to all who mourn, and a sure and certain hope in your loving care, that casting all their sorrow on you, they may have strength for the days ahead. Lord, in your mercy, grant to us who are still in our pilgrimage and who walk as yet by faith, that where this world groans in grief and pain, your Holy Spirit may lead us to bear witness to your light and life. Lord, in your mercy, help us in the midst of things we cannot understand to believe and trust in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection to life everlasting. Lord, in your mercy. God of all grace, we give you thanks because by his death, our Savior Jesus Christ destroyed the power of death, and by his resurrection, he opened the kingdom of heaven to all. Make us certain that because he lives, we shall live also, and that neither death nor life, nor things present nor things to come, will be able to separate us from your love in Christ Jesus our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And now, Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Let us commend Rosalind to the mercy of God, our Maker and Redeemer. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant Rosalind. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive her into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. Amen. Now may Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit bless you now and forever. Amen.
Thank you.
Following the service, all are invited to join the family in the fellowship hall for a reception that is just out of the doors and this way. All right. Let us go forth in peace in the name of Christ. Amen.